All right, welcome back to our series of lectures for MS-200. This video is going to be talking about graphical terrain analysis overlay and how we build that. All right, these are just some examples of GTAOs to give you just an idea of what we're moving towards and what you need to be able to produce. Let's start with how do we build the actual GTAO. That's what this is about. All right, just as a reminder, we've got our mandatory items coming out of every overlay, all right, and you can go see the other information on that. So make sure you've got all the markings that need to be on your overlay. Now, the way these things work with overlays, the whole point of using them is we can overlay them on top of each other. You get these pieces of clear plastic, so you can look at different pieces of it at a time, all right. Now, as we build this up, we can talk about putting our GTAO in layers. All right, there's kind of an optional thing. So we've got our map at the bottom. And kind of an optional thing is whether or not you want to lay out every road and every water system, every little stream on there. You can make an overlay that shows those things. Now that helps you because sometimes the map is too much to look at. And you can take a white sheet of paper and put it between all your overlays and see the terrain in that sense without the rest of the map mucking it up. And having those roads and waterways there might help you out, all right? Now, next layer we want to talk about is our mobility layer, all right? You got to have that on your GTAO. And then the next thing that you go through and put on there is your avenues of approach and your key terrain to show where those are. So this should be review from when we talked about terrain analysis, all right? We've got three classifications for our terrain. We've got unrestricted, restricted, and severely restricted. Now, across the bottom of the image here, you can see the different way that we're going to mark the map. So if it's unrestricted terrain, something that you can move across really, really easily with your forces, we just leave it alone on the map, right? That's just a big empty blank spot, okay? Things that we can easily move through. Now your restricted terrain that might hinder your movement a little bit, all right? You might have to detour around something that you run into that's not shown on the map. Maybe there's some hills on there that you gotta deal with. That we're gonna put, we're gonna mark out the boundary of the area and then put single cross lines through there, all right? Just in one direction, diagonal lines all over that area to fill it in. Then in your severely restricted areas, that's where basically your no-go terrain, things are gonna be really hard to move through. Maybe we can get through it with dismounts, but it's gonna take either specialized equipment like, you know, climbing gear, or it's gonna take a lot of extra time, but it could be beneficial to do that. For those, we're gonna mark out the perimeter of the area, where that is, and then we're gonna put crosshatches in it. In both directions. All right, so crosshatches show us that severely restricted terrain, single lines are what are going to mark our restricted terrain. That's really those two points are the most important thing you need to know about this. All right, so let's talk about when we're looking at our map. All right, so on the left here, I've got a map view with some contour lines. We've got this path from A to B. All right, now pause, think to yourself, what does that route look like and do I want to walk it? Now, if I make a profile of that, all right, so we're showing the location of A and B on the right-hand side. That's that arrow on top. But now we're looking at the side of that hill. That's what those contour lines translate into. So yeah, that's kind of steep there on the left of that hillside. All right, that's severely restricted terrain. All right, we can't get up that unless we're gonna make a major climbing operation out of it. So on the right on the profile, we can mark off the cliff basically that we've got. And on the map, we need to show that same area of where that is, all right? Okay, so when we read our maps, you also have to know what all of the symbology on it means. So if we zoom in here, you've got this thing labeled on the map, all right? It's not, I mean, there's a little bit of blue there, but that's not just a stream. There's all these little red, you know, hash marks on it. What is that? Right? What does that mean? It's not a contour line. I should be able to just cross that, you know. Well, if you go and look at the key on that symbol, that's a man-made storm drainage ditch. All right. Now, one, if we've had a lot of weather lately, then this might be full of water and that'll turn into a river crossing operation at that point. But even if it's not, you know, this is a linear danger area. All right. This is also going to be a bit of a scramble to try and get up if you get down into there. So that's a restricted terrain kind of thing. If you've got vehicles, that's severely restricted. I can't cross that, right? That's basically a tank ditch. So you know, we got to understand what all the symbols on the map mean sometimes and figure out how those might interact with our terrain issues. Okay, our avenues of approach are the next thing we lay out. Now, avenues of approach are built up out of mobility corridors. All right, what's a mobility corridor? It's just the part of the map that I can move through. Now, if I've already done my terrain analysis of my categories of terrain, right, my slow go, my no go areas, and mark those off, you see these gaps between them. And that's where I might mark off mobility corridors. I could go through there. Now, in the symbol of this thing in the middle, it's not just two lines means mobility corridor. This is an example, all right? That is the unit size indicator. So that is a battalion-sized mobility corridor. This is a platoon-sized mobility corridor, all right? Which can be much more narrow because I don't need as much space to move a platoon through as I do to move a whole battalion front through, okay? Now, I've gone out and found some old doctrinal references. Now, this is complete guidelines. This is not hard and fast rules, but to help you have an idea of how wide these things need to be, all right? When you start talking about pushing a brigade through a place, you need like a 3 kilometer width, all right? If we're gonna put a battalion through about 1.5 kilometers, company about 500, you can find things. If you wanna put a platoon through a, you know, between two hills or down a valley, you're gonna need maybe 200 meters roughly in that neighborhood. Now, you can adjust all of that based on other factors of the terrain and what kind of troops do you have? Is that a mounted formation? What formations do I need? I also say those sound large, but that's the whole unit on front, right? So if you want your whole platoon, you know, frontage with every squad shoulder to shoulder, you're gonna need about 200 meters to do that or more. So if we want to push through in a platoon file with squads in squad column, then, you know, we can use a squad size width because we're going one squad at a time. You go all the way down to a single individual path, right? I can put my whole platoon down a 3 foot wide path, but it's going to be one person at a time. That's a one person mobility corridor. All right. So we can lay out our mobility corridors here and mark those off if we want on the map. All right, I'm back. Apparently this room has motion sensors in it and I wasn't moving enough, but I got to turn the video off so you can see the whole picture. And I had totally lost where we're at now. But okay, so you can lay out your mobility corridors for where those are, and then you can build up something. So if I need to push my platoon through, I need to find, you know, potentially 3 squad mobility corridors. If I can find that, I can make an avenue of approach that uses them, right? So maybe first squad is going on the north side of a piece of restricted terrain and second and third squad are going south of it, right? So I don't necessarily need to have platoon size corridors to move my entire unit. All right, that brings us to key terrain. This is the other thing you gotta make sure you include on here. We already covered key terrain when we talked about how to do terrain analysis using a COCA, all right? Just make sure that your key terrain is actually key terrain. Don't use every hilltop out there, all right? And make sure it's something related to both sides of the fight would benefit from controlling it, all right? Now, key terrain, because it's both sides, red and blue, red plus blue gives you purple, all right? So that should be marked in purple, all right? All right, so that concludes this video. All right, just make sure that when you do your graphical terrain analysis overlay, that you include your key terrain, that you include the avenues of approach, and that you include your categories of terrain for restricted and severely restricted to help you figure out your mobility on that. All right, and then make sure you put all of the overlay marking materials on there. All right, if you want to, optional, you can mark out every road and stream in the area. All right, have a great day. See you in class.